Would you like me to do it again?
Yes, please.
The time is 12 o'clock. I'm calling to order the meeting of Paris Union High School District meeting to order at 12 o'clock. That was two times, sorry. Item 3.1, invitation to address the Board of Trustees.
No, no takers.
Thank you. Item 4.1, adjourn to closed session. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Mr. Nelson?
Second.
And Mr. Stafford? Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 4.1 is a 5-0 vote. We'll be going to closed session at 12:01.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Item 5.1 is reconvening in public session. The board meeting will reconvene at approximately 1:54 p.m. Item 6.1, report out of closed session.
No report out of closed session.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Item 7.1 is adjournment. Do I have a motion?
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 7.1 is a 5-0 vote. This meeting is adjourned at 1:55 p.m. All right. The time is 3:03 p.m. I'd like to call to order the Paris Union High School District Board meeting to order. 3:03. I'm going to ask for a roll call. Trustee Nelson?
Here.
Trustee Vallejo?
Here.
Trustee Stafford?
Here.
Trustee Campos?
Here.
And myself, we're all here. We've established a quorum. Item 3.1, invitation to address the Board of Trustees on closed session items only.
No cards this evening.
No cards. Am I on the right one, sir? So we do have...
We have one card pulled that will come into closed session to talk with the board from Ms. Fowles.
So she doesn't need to go up to the mic and say anything? Okay. All right. Item 4.1, adjourn to closed session. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. I didn't vote.
That was the last vote.
Yeah.
Because they had my move and Tony second originally.
Yeah, this is during the closed session.
I'm sorry? Okay. No, this just popped up.
Took the vote from the last board meeting, so.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Oh, here we go.
It just moved.
Yes, it's showing. So you want us to vote electronically and not verbally? Okay. Please vote. Item 4.1 passes, 5-0 vote. And we will be adjourning to closed session at 3:05. The time is 5:39. We will now reconvene in public session. And if you could please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you all for being here today. Can we just have a moment of silence for anybody in the district and in our community that's having troubles, physical, mental, emotional, anything like that? Just a moment of silence for them, please. Thank you very much. Please have a seat.
Item 7.1, recess. The board president will recess the meeting to conduct the regular board meeting of the California Military Institute Charter School. What? At 5:41. Anna, is that correct? 1.1? Item 2.1, call to order. There we go. I'm going to ask for a roll call to determine a quorum. Trustee Nelson? Oh, my bad. 5:39. Yes, I already said that, yeah. So you want me to go 5:41?
I thought we're
good.
You want to pause at 5:41 when you're opening this?
You know what? You're right. Thank you. The time is 5:42 now. There we go. Is that better?
Here.
Trustee Vallejo.
Here.
Trustee Stafford.
Here.
Trustee Campos.
Here.
And myself here. We have a quorum. Item 3.1, revision, adoption, ordering of agenda, March 20th, 24. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? See none, please vote. Item 3.1 is a 5-0 vote. Item 4.1, student representatives to the Board of Trustees.
I believe that's me. So from CMI, Student Representative Cadet Captain Ariana Abreeze-Smith.
All right, we're going to move on in the meantime. Item 4.2, CMITA President Angel Love Behrens.
Good evening, President Garcia, Vice President Campos, Mr. Stafford, Ms. Vallejo, and Mr. Nelson. what I don't have on my paper, I do want to thank you, Mr. Nelson, for your moment of silence. My first thought was to going to the difficulties and stresses many of our students face. They are coupled not only with a great deal more difficult society-wise than I think any other generation has ever had to face, and the stresses at home economically, and then the stresses of academic success that's so expected of them. And I know that we all in this room and much beyond on every site really strive to do as much as we can for those students. So thank you, because it gave me pause for a moment. January 19th, 2001 was my first day as an employee of this district. And all these years, I've been part of this institution, the Board of Trustees, the Cabinet, and the superintendents that have always worked diligently for this district, have worked hard at keeping cuts as far away from classroom as possible. I stand here hoping that that mindset continues with this board, this cabinet, as we stare down what looks to be another tough financial period for schools up and down the state of California. I've been assured, at least temporarily for now, by Mr. Skorpanich and my principal, that for right now, that's not in our discussion for CMI. I hope it stays that way, but I am a realist. I know that a lot of that is out of our control, especially mine, being at the site. It is somewhat in your control, but some of that control lies in Sacramento. There is one thing, one action I can take that can hopefully help in some small way. I will be attending a lobbying session with CTA in Sacramento in June, where we are going to be addressing specifically assembly and district Senate members from our district, specifically about the budget. And my plea to them will be to keep the cuts at state level as far away from the classroom as we can. It is the only thing that I can do in the face of what we're looking at. So I hope my voice at that level is heard. On a lighter note, I am pleased to inform you all that our negotiations are going well. We have a few articles that we have been able to TA. Thanks to Kirk and Mirabelle and Candace and Myra and Dr. M for working really well with us. Our main focus with the whole renewal of our CBA this year is clarifying language. We have all the hard parts of our contract, but so that misinterpretation is decreased and understanding is increased on it. That's what we're seeking this year. One major discovery that we have found, Kirk will throw something at me, I think, that we need a handbook. We don't have a teacher handbook for our site. And PSEAs is great, but like everything else, we are kind of the oddball out, and not all of it applies to us. So we look forward to hopefully meeting with the new people in student services and maybe hopefully making that happen sooner rather than later. I don't want to wait another 10 to 12 years for a handbook. As my unit members head into the back half of the semester with finals, graduation, and the ending of 23-24 school year coming at us in warp speed, we are busier than ever with interventions, LPAC testing, preparation for SBAC finals, grades, parent and teacher conferences and meetings and phone calls, as well as looking at the 24-25 school year. I thank you for your time, even though saying 25 really makes me feel old. Thank you.
Item 4.3, President Rosa Galvan. Oh, pardon me, from CSEA.
Good evening, Board of Education, Superintendent Mr. Bennett, and others here today. My name is Rosa Galvan, the chapter president of the California Military Institute Chapter 778 of the California School Employees Association for the second year. I am here to formally introduce our new executive board officers for the 2024 term. Our new secretary, Ms. Christina Sanchez, and our new treasurer, Tracy S.C. Markopoulos. We are very excited to continue working with the charter this year. Our chapter is moving forward, and soon we'll have two more positions on the board. Very proud for our memberships for making this happen. I have applied as well for delegate assistance to represent our chapter at the CSEA annual conference from July 28th to August 1st in San Jose, California, hoping to hear from them soon. Also, our negotiations team, along with me and our CSEA labor relationships representative, Maisha Kennedy, have been very dedicated and working persistently with CMI administration and the district to wrap up negotiations for our first contract ever. I have to say that we are addressing any items as they arise in a very reasonable, collective, and timely manner. I have experienced and learned so much about our powerful union and the work CSEA does to improve the lives of our members, students, and our community. We look forward to working with CMI administration, the district, and this Board of Education as we continue moving forward in our journey as a California Schools Employees Association and its CMI Chapter 778. Thank you.
Item 4.4, Principals Update.
Ms. Behrens, you're a veteran, but Ms. Galvan, that was wonderful. Great job. Good to see you all this evening, President Garcia, board members, Superintendent Bennett, and Cabinet. Have a very brief principal update for you tonight. For it to load up. All right. There and I'm fine. Very excited to let you know that CMI has received over 250 new applications. That's a big deal for us. That is a record number for us, much larger than in the previous year. So I'm very excited to see that. It indicates the community trusts the work that our teachers are doing, our classified staff is doing. And, it just speaks to the testimony of the quality of the school. The staff. Our attendance, as of right now, it's approximately 95%. That's what we'd like to see. That is our target, and we're working very, very hard to make that happen at CMI. Moving forward, CMI has received a superior rating. This is a third year in a row, annual general inspection. This is a big deal. I'm just going to brag about our cadets. I'm going to brag even about our staff. We have to stand there for, you know, a good 30, 40 minutes. If you can imagine 1,000 cadets fully dressed in the uniform out there on the field, while members of different branches of the military are inspecting them, walking through, asking them random questions about knowledge, and inspecting their uniform. It's incredible what our young people can do in this community when given the opportunity to shine. And so again, credit to our cadets, their parents, and our staff for truly making this support. The highest rating you can get from the California Cadet Corps. Positive behavior interventions and supports, you've heard this word used a lot, essentially looking for other means of correction as opposed to punitive. So CMI was invited to apply for a silver status as an entire school based on the work that we have been doing far. And again, I'm very thankful to our staff for leading this work and making this happen. I'll keep you informed of the progress. But we care about our students, and we want to make sure that we're providing corrective action where needed, particularly in terms of educating about what to do, what not to do, how to do it prior to going to any punitive actions. Moving forward, in addition, I've been sharing with you for quite some time about our work with Solution Tree, as you know, professional learning communities. That is essentially the goal of all of our educational communities. John Hattie's research is so clear that when our educators work together, right, great things can happen as opposed to working in silos. And so Solution Tree is the company that provides that professional development for our teachers. And CMI has been engaged in this work for the last several years. And the Solution Tree company has invited us to apply for the Promising Practices School, which is the first step towards being a model professional learning community school, a very difficult thing to achieve. It'll take a little bit more time, but this is a great first step for us. So I'll keep you updated on how that work is going. And finally, LPAC testing, we're 98% complete. I actually see Dr. Petter Peterson back there. You want to just wave real quick? She's our ELL coach. I didn't know she would be here this evening, but she's leading the work, and I'm very proud of the team alongside our testing coordinator, Ms. Tarpley, and the other staff working so hard to make this happen for our site and our students. I will leave it that for this evening. Thank you so much for your attention.
All right, thank you. Item 5.1, invitation to address the Board of Trustees on non-agendized items.
No takers tonight.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. Item 6.1, consent calendar. Approval of consent calendar items. Do I have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Who was my second? Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 6.1 is a 5-0 vote. Item 7.1, discipline. February 2024 monthly suspension report. It's just information. Item 8.1, personnel, is an action item. Is there for certificated personnel action items? Do I have a motion? Second.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 8.1 is a 5-0 vote. Item 8.2, personnel, classified personnel action items. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Is a 5-0 vote. God bless you. Item 9.1, curriculum. Revised middle school science courses, science 5, science 6, science 7, and science 8. Item 9.2, curriculum, revised science course, environmental science meets A through G requirements. D. Item 9.3, curriculum, revised advanced placement social science courses, AP government, AP human geography, and AP psychology meets A through G requirement A. Item 9.4, curriculum, revised world language courses, American Sign Language 1, American Sign Language 2, American Sign Language 3, American Sign Language 3 honors, American Sign Language 4 honors, meets A through G requirement E. Item 9.5, curriculum, revised world language courses, French 3 honors, meets A through G requirement E. Item 9.6, curriculum, revised world language courses, Spanish 1, 2, 3, Spanish 3 honors, AP Spanish 4, Language and Culture, Spanish for Spanish Speakers 1 and Spanish for Spanish Speakers 2 meets A through G requirement E. Item 9.7, New Career Technical Education Course under the Agriculture Pathway, 103 Agriculture Environmental Service.
Science. Can I move your
iron, Avery's? Yay, how about that? Meets A through G requirement D. Item 9.8, Curriculum, New Career Technical Education Course under the Agricultural Pathway, 101 Agriculture Mechanics 2 meets A through G requirement G. Item 9.9, Curriculum, New World Language Course, American Sign Language 4 meets A through G requirement E. Item 10.1, Other Items by the Superintendent.
Dylan, I'd just like to share. I'm looking forward to Saturday evening. I get to spend it with the CMI Military Ball out at March Air Base, I believe. So it'll be fun to see the kids all dressed up and wearing their fancy uniforms and stuff. It's always a good time. So thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett. 11.1, Other Items by the Board of Trustees. Trustee Nelson.
All right, I'm being told that the video is ready to go whenever we want to, but nothing for me for this month. Thank you, though.
Thank you. Trustee Vallejo?
So I just want to say thank you to all the staff at CMI. You guys are doing great with the attendance rate and the inspection, and I just want to say that I'm very proud to see how great you are all doing, and congratulations to all the students, too. So thank you.
Trustee Stafford.
I also would like to congratulate you on your attendance. That's a huge thing for the district. It's always been strong at CMI. Thank you for doing the great work you do over there, and hope to see you soon.
Okay. Thank you. Trustee Campos.
Yeah, just a thank you, and I'm glad to see the band's back together because it's been a while since we've seen all three, so I want to hear from you. So it's great to hear your voice and see you guys here tonight. And obviously, thank you for the continued work that you guys do there. We're proud of it. Thank you.
Well, it seems like everybody said what I wanted to say, so thank you. All right, item 12.1, adjournment of the regular meeting of California Military. Oh, wait, yes, we do. Thank you, sir. Can we show the video, please?
Good afternoon. I'm Cadet Major Ariana Abreeze, and I'll be going over the events and activities for the month of March. So first, I would like to go over our annual general inspection, also known as AGI, which took place on March 6th. For this inspection, we had four areas that were graded: our formation inspection, the drill and ceremonies, our command briefing, and the inspection of our brigade files. For this event, we had nine guest inspectors, which were military personnel from the Army, Navy, Air National Guard, and Army National Guard. And as a result, we were awarded the superior rating, which is the highest rating that you can receive, and this marks our third consecutive superior rating. Here's some more pictures from AGI. We have our inspection, which is a picture on the left and on the bottom right. Then we have our drill and ceremonies, which is the picture on the top middle. Then our command briefing, which is on the bottom middle picture. And on the top right picture, you'll see that is our file inspection. Then for MHD, our MHD this month took place on March 7th. We had a total of 16 members on the MHD team, 6 being ushers, 7 on rifle team. Then we had our MHD commander, the bugler, and also our showgirl. And we had a total of 3 services that day. Then for our community service, so we've had 2 key community service opportunities for the month of March. Dino Train being the first, which is an event like Thomas the Train, took place on March 16th to the 17th. And we had, being 2 days, our first day, we had a total of 46 cadets. And on the second day, March 17th, we had a total of 38 cadets. Then we had another community service opportunity, the Paris Historical Society Annual Installation Dinner, which took place on March 17th, and we had 10 cadet participants where they helped serve food at the local church. Then for promotion boards, they took place on March 11th through the 15th. We had a total of 63 cadets taking boards, 8 parent volunteers, 5 military advisors, and also 5 guardsmen. And we also had other cadet staff helping out with the boards and also sitting in on boards. And what the volunteers and military advisors and guardsmen did is they sat in on the boards and they graded those who were taking and participating in boards. So for our upcoming events, we have our 19th annual military ball coming up on March 23rd, so this Saturday. And we have our Administrator Awards Night Color Guard, so we will be performing a color guard for that event on March 25th at the Moreno Valley Conference Center. Then our promotion ceremonies, we'll be having promotion ceremonies this week. So for Cadet through Corporal, we have their promotion ceremony on this Thursday, March 21st. Then the promotion ceremony for Sergeant is going to be on Friday, March 22nd. And seeing as we just conducted our boards, the date for the promotion ceremonies is to be determined, but for Sergeants and above, we just did those books. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, moving on. Item 12.1, adjournment of the regular meeting of the California Military Institute for March 20th, 2024. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you. Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 12.1, adjournment, is a 5-0 vote at 6:06 p.m. Please log in. All right, 8.1, revision adoption ordering of agenda, March 20th, 24. Is there a motion?
So moved.
We are reconvening at 6:07. Do I need to hit the hammer again? Okay, I'm sorry. Is there a motion?
Yeah.
So, okay. Tony, I'll take the second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 8.1 is a 5-0 vote. Moving on to oral reports. 9.1, report out of closed session.
We have one item out of closed session we'd like to report this evening. In closed session, the board took action to promote Julie Mendoza Blyde as principal of Paloma Valley High School effective March 21st, 2024 by the following vote, 5-0. We're looking forward to the continued leadership she's done down there as an interim, and it's great to be able to have her take the reins. That concludes the report out of closed session.
All right. Item 9.2, update by the superintendent.
We have a few things we're going to talk about tonight. I'm going to start out with the rave awards. We have some rave awards. We haven't done them the last couple months, but we're ready to bring them back. So I'm going to introduce Kirk Skorpanich to come up and
so it's my sincere pleasure to be here this evening and talk about some of the amazing employees that we have. We have, this evening we get to recognize first some of our incredible certificated and classified staff members from Paloma Valley. So I'd like to bring up Jason Hart, Heaven Boone, Cameron Lindreth, Hannah Bowden, and Sergeant Puebla. Please welcome them up. So before I let you guys sit down, because we're not there yet, I need to embarrass you. So part of the reason that we do the RAVE Awards is it stands for recognizing all valuable employees. And sometimes it means going above and beyond. Sometimes it means just doing their job really well and just being amazingly awesome. And we have examples of both of that here this evening with all of our RAVE Award recipients. So I'd like to start with Ms. Boone. We'll start with that. She is a science teacher. And I want to say these individuals are also selected by our site administration. And so this was written by Ms. Blythe, and so you can kind of hear it in the narration she does. She's a science teacher that she wishes that she had. She is engaging, supports all students, and uses real-life connections to engage students. Recently, we walked by her classroom and saw students dropping blood drops, measuring the blood, and identifying the splatter differences would cause. The students were eager to learn, which is a testament of her enthusiasm to teach. So congratulations. And next we have Master Sergeant Puebla. He can go on making millions being a motivational speaker. That's according to Ms. Blythe. When he speaks, everyone in the room listens. Day in and day out, he guides the Paloma cadets to be the best they can be. And he can often still be found on campus in the evening and on weekends. If it were possible, every student would go through a year with him at the helm, and Paloma would be the most motivating, had the most motivating students in the state. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And if we could, we'd like the board to come down and we could take a picture of you guys together.
Also on Friday, they're having their pass and review down at Paloma Valley.
You're absolutely correct, Friday, sir. Evening. Everyone's invited. Free event, 5:30. They're in the gymnasium. It's gonna be great. Everybody's invited. Paloma Valley. Come on.
So guys can... All right, and we're gonna have you guys right over here. And it might, you know, we have a few more. You guys want to stay down here?
No.
So as Mr. Bennett shared, we had skipped and held off on doing a couple of them last few months. So now it's our opportunity of recognizing our amazing employees and rave about them from our PALS program. That's right. So we would like to invite up Marlene Lee K. Scott.
Woo, Marlene.
All right, Marlene. And then Gentry Cusick. Woo! And Rachel Post. Woo!
Thank you.
And then Cecilia Belmontes. So I'm not going to read everything on here because it will be here all night just to talk about how amazing you guys are. We'll just cover some of the highlights. So I'd like to begin with Marlene, with Ms. Scott right here. And so she is an invaluable part of our floater paraeducator team. So we've designated a handful of paraeducators to kind of go at whatever site is needed on any given day to fill in for vacancies. And so she's dependable, she's reliable, and she's always filling in to make sure that the needs of our students with special needs are always met wherever they're at in the district. So congratulations and thank you. Yes. And Ms. Cusick is a remarkable teacher at our Pathways for Adult Life skills, and she's created a learning environment that has transformed the lives of some of our most impacted students for the 2 years that she's been there. So above and beyond, she's done a million other things and stuff, but that's a highlight of it. Congratulations. Rachel Post. We was recognized last year as one of our teachers of the year, and then this year it's bittersweet that we get to recognize her today, but it's also her last year. She's going to be retiring, and she has just impacted the lives of students her entire career with us. Everyone that has the opportunity of visiting her classroom and seeing her teach gets to know what an amazing, amazing teacher she is and the legacy that she's leaving with us. So she actually began her career with the Paris Union High School District as a paraeducator, and then she moved into a teaching role from there. She's a monumental part of the implementation of Pathways to Graduation for our PAL students. In fact, we had 19 students earn their high school diploma this year, and that's directly a result of Ms. Post and the work that she's done. So congratulations, and we appreciate you. And last but not least, Ms. Belmontes, and she is a spectacular classroom paraeducator. She's a quiet force that's always willing to take on challenging situations. She's worked recently with some of our most severely challenging students over at PALS and has just done an awesome job of always meeting every student's needs. She's gentle, she's kind, she's caring, and she has optimism in everything she does, creating a positive work environment over at PALS. So congratulations, and we appreciate you. So if we can have all of you come on over here with the board too, we'll get a picture of you as well. Come on in, thank you, sir. Go for it. Okay, we've got the paparazzi, so we'll just kind of go down the line.
Got it.
Okay, here we go. Let me get the one. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Congratulations. We appreciate you. One more. Mr. Bennett, we still got one more. Employees of the year. Yeah. And the next group that we're going to recognize are the individuals that epitomize the very best of the Paris Union High School District. And these are our employees of the year. And it's an opportunity of recognizing the great work that they do. And they're going to not only be recognized here in the Paris Union High School District as Employees of the Year, but they also represent the district for the county Employees of the Year. And they just are amazing people. If you visit their classroom, you see the work that they do at their sites, we get to see just how amazing they are. So I'd like to bring them up together, and when I call you up, if you guys can come up right here, and we'll have you right with the board. Our LaDon Johnson, Teacher of the Year. Right up here with him, yep. Our other Teacher of the Year from Liberty High School is Diane Pales. It's an honor to recognize our Classified Employee of the Year, and that is our Nutrition Services Assistant, Christina Macias. Our Confidential Employee of the Year is someone that our board knows very well, and that is Anna Fetzner. As soon as I called her name, Anna just goes, "Oh my God, I gotta come up there." Our Classified Administrator of the Year is Audrey Mitchell. Our Certificated Administrator of the Year is Erica Heliger Garcia. Our Principal of the Year, for a second time in a couple years, is Mr. Juan Santos. Our Site Support Employee of the Year is Mr. Kevin Lamb. And rounding out our all-stars this year of our employees is our Counselor of the Year, and that's Esperanza Hope Solis. And as I mentioned, each of them is representing the district. It'll be at the county's employee recognition event later on, and then they'll also be recognized locally in our event, which we're looking forward to in May here. So with that, we're going to grab a picture of everyone. If anyone wants a picture, you can get a grab this time, too.
Oh, we do.
Yeah.
All the prop principals here.
This
I want to say to Miss Belmontes and Miss Cusick, you're both way better than your husbands. Okay, I just have a couple other things. Last couple weeks been attending a lot of open houses at the different high schools and all of our schools. Great to see the parents out there supporting the kids as they do an eighth grade orientation, and also seeing the eighth grade parents come on our sites and really be excited. And last thing I have this coming Saturday, we have our 13th annual Puma Golf Tournament. We're playing out at Seven Hills in Hemet, and we raise money to give scholarships to the kids graduating from our schools, and we're the largest donors to the Student of the Year program. So we're really proud about that. I think we have 76 golfers playing this year. We'll clear about $10,000 to be able to give that out to our kids. So thank you. Then that'll conclude my report.
And unfortunately, you guys, we have to reboot the system, so we're going to take about a 10-minute break. Oh, wait. Oh. See, you guys are awesome. You guys are awesome. Kudos. You guys deserve a wave award for that. Okay. All right. So 9.3, student representatives to the Board of Trustees. And we will start with Trustee Nelson.
Yep, that's me, I believe. From Heritage High School, here's open. Hearing from Heritage High School, student representatives Rashad Anderson and Isabella Martin.
Of the board, Mr. Bennett, and members of the cabinet. My name is Bella Martin.
And I'm Rashad Anderson.
And we are excited to show you what has been happening here at Heritage in the month of March.
On March 5th, several members from the United States Army came out to present different careers that the Army offers. The students were able to learn about Army careers in some of the following areas: medical, cyber intelligence, law enforcement, logistics, aeronautics. Students from the following classes attended college and career, law enforcement, government, and economics.
March 7th and March 8th was the dance team's 17th annual dance showcase that was composed of solos, duets, and team performances. They opened up on a Thursday night and sold out Friday night. A massive shout out to Coach Burns for all of her dedication, as well as the dancers for their extremely hard work and late nights. Keep up the phenomenal work.
On March 19th was our third campus culture fair, where multiple clubs came out during lunch to show the campus what they are about, explaining their vision and their purpose to the student body and how it contributes to our campus culture. This year we had 21 clubs come out, and this was all put together by Senior Chair Flores, backed by Ms. Johnson and Ms. Betts. It was a very positive experience for our students, and we look forward to continuing the next school year.
Our March Student of the Month goes to Nandi Dogani. She is currently sitting at a 3.875 GPA, is involved in Link Crew, is taking multiple advanced classes, as well as being involved in even more clubs. Thank you, Nandi, for all that you contribute to Heritage.
Here's a list of upcoming events. Link Crew's Ice Cream Social is going to be on March 20th. FFA State Conference is going to be through the 21st and the 25th of March. We have the Page Olympics on the 22nd of March. The prom season beginning on March 25th. FAFSA Fiesta is going to be on April 9th, Avid Parent Night on April 10th, and the Spring Rally in Ontario Rain Game is going to be on April 12th.
That concludes our presentation. Thank you so much for the continued support of Heritage, and thank you for your time.
Trustee Campos.
Hello, I have the honor to introduce Liberty High School student representatives Moses Madrigal and Morgan Tam.
members of the board, Mr. Bennett, and the cabinet. I'm Morgan Tam.
And I'm Moses Madrigal.
And this is our February through March recap.
Liberty continues with the Student of the Month program, this month's nominee being Lila Montalban.
Liberty welcomed incoming Bison and their families on campus to tour our school and meet our teachers and counselors. Our clubs hosted booths to get students interested and involved on campus. We also sold out on new merch at our student store.
We also reached out to future Bison at Bell Mountain and Harvest Hill Middle School. Representatives from our various clubs, pathways, and programs came to give speeches, answer questions, and hand out flyers.
March 18th starts our two-week-long campaigns for next year's AHB presidents. Each grade has at least two groups in competition. Polls open March 27th and close at 3:30 on March 28th.
To celebrate upcoming ASB elections and to test the candidates, ASB will be hosting an Election Spirit Week.
Liberty Winter Sports, which reached CIF, were girls soccer, girls basketball, boys basketball, wrestling, and girls water polo. Some upcoming events are ASB elections, the Election Spirit Week, the Spring Pep Rally, the Prom Spirit Week, and prom.
And as always, go Bison!
Trustee Stafford.
From Paloma Valley High School, student representatives Addison Garcia and Cassandra Madigal.
Hello, Paris Union School Board and Superintendent Mr. Bennett. I'm Cassie Madrigal, one of two of this year's ASB secretaries.
And I'm Addison Garcia, one of this year's ASB junior representatives.
Congratulations to our cheerleader team for placing third place overall at their nationals, as well as our song team for placing first place in their division. Way to represent Wildcats.
February 27th and March 5th, our counselors and Wildcats went to Catherine Newport and Menifee Valley to showcase our clubs and sports.
Congratulations to our very own cadet, Dylan Jackson. He earned the $180,000 NRTC scholarship and will be attending USD in the upcoming fall.
Congrats to our engineering Wildcats, where on March 4th, they went to the MESA competition at UCR and placed first, second, and third.
March 4th, we hosted our Spring Pep Rally, where we honored our sports as well as our performance teams. That same day, we hosted our very own Food Truck Frenzy. The event went amazing, and we can't wait to see how it'll expand next year.
March 12th, we hosted an open house for our future Wildcats and their parents to get a feel for our clubs, our classes, and to get to know our counselors and teachers.
Congratulations to our NJRCC Battlecats for once again placing first place overall at the USS Midway competition. They have gone back to back to back four-time champions. Congratulations, Wildcats.
February 29th, we hosted Pearson Heritage here at Paloma Valley for an intense game of unified PE flag football with our plus kids, where it went amazing and we dominated the competition.
Some of our upcoming events include prom, grad night, as well as senior awards. That's all for today. See you next time. Bye!
I have the honor of introducing student representatives Jesus Alvarado and Kayla Rosales.
Good morning, School Board and Cabinet. I'm Kayla Rosales.
And I'm Jesus Alvarado.
And these are our announcements for the months of February to March.
All right, we're going to be starting with our Spirit Week. We had the first Monday, which was anything but a water bottle day. And Tuesday was Botas Day. And then on Wednesday, we had our Black Panther Day, which we celebrated alongside with Black History Month and had our Telly's Table come and cater. And then on Thursday was Loteria Day, which everyone got to dress up as a Loteria card. And then on Friday, we had our class wars. Seniors were red.
Juniors were blue.
Sophomores were white.
And the freshmen were orange.
And then after, on Friday, we also had our Spring Fling Dance, which was Jaripeo theme. Boys to Men attended the Young Men's Conference, and it was a life-changing experience.
On February 28th, we had our Black History Month celebration that we had talked about earlier, where Telly's Tables got to cater.
On March 1st, going back, we had our Spring Fling Dance, which we also had a DJ, our very own DJ, and our very own Grupo Herencia de Culiacan, and then alongside, we had a banda for the dance.
On March 7th, we had our final blood drive. We had almost over 50 donators.
Sixth, I am proud to announce that the Panthers esports team had emerged victorious once more, putting us at an overall 5-1 record. We approached the end of our season.
Eduardo Guzman, Alexis Guzman, and Mark Guzman played a gritty back-and-forth match against Elsinore High School yesterday afternoon.
They came out ahead, beating Elsinore 3-1 and secure the victory. We are currently ranked 52 in the state of California. We expect to continue climbing the leaderboards during the final 3 matches of our regular season.
On March 13th, our girls swim team defeated Canyon Springs girls swim team. This was our first win in 3 years.
Thank you for watching.
Trustee Vallejo.
I would like to welcome the Paris Lake High School student reps, Joanna Alvarez, Alondra Leon Arenas, Ariana Najera, and Jose Ortiz Mejia.
Welcome to Falcon Focus, take 8.
Welcome Falcon Focus, my name's Joanna.
And my name's Ariana.
My name is Jose.
And my name's Alondra. Today we're going to talk about events that we've been have going on and events that are going to be coming up. Like the new project that came and helped us set up the equipment.
And also the military people that came and taught us about what they do.
Have you guys heard the new Spirit Week?
Yeah, we heard that on Monday we're having a Falcon Week.
I heard we're having this Del Color Spirit Week. Instead of talking, we're going to show you guys a video.
You wanna go where everybody knows your name?
Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows your name.
Item 9.4, Jason Miller.
Mr. Miller told me he had a family engagement. He couldn't make it this evening.
Not a problem. Thank you. 9.5, CSEA President Helen Steinmeck.
Good evening, President Garcia, members of the board, Superintendent Mr. Bennett, and Cabinet. My name is Helen Steinmeck, and I became the president of nearly 500 classified members of Chapter 469 on February 22nd, after Nathaniel Nash stepped down to begin a new chapter of his life out of state. It has been an extremely busy time this past month assuming the new duties as president. I'm grateful to my director, Dr. Cassandra McNair, as well as Maribel and Kirk, for allowing me the flexibility to get comfortable again in that role, whether it was on the negotiating team, in CRCs, and even in problem-solving sessions. We have a lot to get accomplished in a few short months before the school year ends. We are working on numerous MOUs and preparing to sunshine articles for reopeners, as well as keeping our members informed of all the peaks and valleys that are foreshadowing the future of this district financially. The biggest struggle is in educating our members to understand the processes, procedures, and reasons regarding the difficult decisions that the board and district administration make. With new members on our negotiating team this year, I am pleased to say that the district took the time to help our members go through the IBB interest-based bargaining process. We met on the 25th of January for a full day of training. We are grateful to Mr. Skorpanich for working so diligently on this process and feel confident that our relationship with the district will continue to be one of mutual understanding and respect. Just 2 short weeks ago, I stood before you personally advocating for saving jobs and programs. Although I did not agree with the board's findings, I respect you all for having to make these tough decisions. Moving forward, as president of Chapter 469, I envision that we will come together to address any future issues that affect all classified employees in an appropriate forum. As the economy continues to weigh on our minds and our paychecks, and we understand that financially the future picture is bleak. However, I have not forgotten the last time I was president and the district wanted to lay off some of our nutrition workers. A few of you were here then and stepped in to support our position. We don't want to go down that road again with any classified positions, and we will work closely with the district to ensure that we are not put into a position that requires board intervention. Finally, my intention is to represent all members of Chapter 469 at Paris Union, and I will strive to be transparent, honest, and forthright. I take this position seriously, and I will serve with integrity and veracity. I'm looking forward to a continued collaborative relationship and welcome the challenges ahead as opportunities for us all. Thank you.
Item 9.6, comments by the Board of Trustees. Mr. Nelson.
Thank you, Mr. President. I went to Open House for Liberty last week, and it was really, really cool to see the incoming eighth graders get a chance to, they had it set up sort of like a rush week over at colleges with booths and everything, get a chance to see what they're interested in, get a chance to get them connected to different clubs. I will also, I believe, be going to see, what is it, Adam's Family. I believe they're doing it over at Paris High School on Friday night. I'm trying to take the family to go see that, so that'll be fun to see. I love to watch high school theater. It's really interesting sometimes, and it's a lot of fun. The kids really get into it, and it's a lot of fun to see. So that will be it for me for tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Vallejo.
I also went to a couple of open houses. I didn't go to all of them. I'm sorry. But the ones that I went to were really great. Liberty was great. Did not know that it looks like Disneyland. I swear there's so many people. There's so many parents. So that was a great experience to go to. Heritage was a very good one, too. And then Pels. They were all great ones. I'm also planning to go to the Adams Family theater play on Friday too, so I'll see you there. And then I actually just want to say, I know we just went through a pretty tough time these past few weeks, but I do want to let all of our staff members know that I know there's a lot of rumors going on, and it's always circulating. But I want you all to know that we, as a board, like, we're all here to serve you. Like, we're all here to be united. And I know it's still a little chaotic right now because you don't know who your next superintendent's going to be. But I just want to reaffirm you all is we all want the best. And who the next person is going to be, it's going to be just as great as Grant. And I just want to let you all know that we will always be united and together for what's best for all the students and staff. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Stafford.
Just want to say hello to everyone. I didn't get out much this last week or two, but I did visit Heritage High School, my old school, and it was nice to be there. And the school looked great. It reminded me of my time there with Grant. So things are looking up, we'll say. That's the most I can say. But we're working hard for you. We want things to be successful for everyone. And decisions are difficult at times, but we think through and we support the staff, and especially our students, you know. And if we could just keep working on our attendance. Attendance is probably one of the most important things. And so everybody be well, have a good weekend, and thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Campos.
Yeah, I kind of, the past month or so, I've kind of been laying low. I'm off next week. I know that you guys had ski week at some point, but I'm off next week, so I will be reaching out to some of the sites, want to go stop by and visit, see what's going on and how we can help support at whatever site that I visit. You know, again, I'm just kind of look for me as a teacher, I know that at certain points in the year, and I think it was probably this past month, you hit a wall. You're tired from just work, and then, you know, your outside obligations, you know, part of being a board member and other things, being active in other kind of local stuff. I apologize for not being as visible, but I'm recharging, and I'm looking forward to my break and hopefully visiting some sites and then coming back and having a bunch of great things to say, but I'm just glad to see that everybody's doing well here tonight, and thank you for your attendance.
Thank you. I want to thank everybody as usual. You know, it's important to know that we care. We listen to everything you guys say. Sometimes we don't make decisions that are in one person's favor per se or opinion, but we do the best to our ability. And I truly value each and every one of you because I know how important each and everybody's role is in this district. And servicing our community is so big for all of us. And we know that you guys are the most important and you're the best at what you do. And we appreciate that. Also, going off in a different direction, I would like to ask the board if we can create an appeal process for certificated and classified employees if they want to appeal to the school board, part of their discipline process. And I would also like that to be an action item for next month, if possible, if I could get your consensus to have that place on the agenda. So that way the district could work with the unions and get that done. Thank you, Mr. Bennett, you have your direction. Thank you. All right, item 10.1, invitation to address the Board of Trustees.
No takers this meeting either.
Thank you. Item 11.1, consent calendar, approval of consent calendar items. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 11.1 is a 5-0 vote. Item 12.1, mid-year local control accountability program update. Diane Martin, Marvin Williams.
I promise, absolutely promise, this is not going to be 45 minutes. Or 40, or 20, maybe 15. Okay. Well, they don't believe me.
All right, on the clock.
Okay, go.
Sarah, I'm reminded you have the kill switch.
The big hook. They're always telling me, land the plane. Okay, I'm going to land the plane. Well, so we are required to provide you with an LCAP mid-year report. So as you know that we've already presented goal 1 and 2 already. So we're really going to kind of dive into goals 3 and 4. My colleagues, the hecklers in the back here, they are available to answer any questions regarding LCAP goal 1 and 2. But the way tonight is structured is we're going to focus on the actions. What we didn't include last time in the reports from goals 1 and 2 are the budget expenditures. And so I've provided that. So you all have a hard copy. So we start off with our budget overview for parents. So this is part of the work that we do in for LCAP, the supplemental concentration. That is the funds that we're talking about tonight. So that's that $29 million. So part of that, we have to inform our public what that dollar amount is. So that's just to share with you. And we work very closely with Mimi and Candace and her team to make sure that we are completely aligned with our budget and our expenditures. And so And you can guide me on how quickly you want me to go through this, but I was going to go through this fairly quickly for 1 and 2, because since you've heard most of this information already. But Mr. Tippy and Mrs. Cahoon are here to answer any questions to go into a little bit deeper. So we have it laid out so that you're looking at the actions that correspond with the goal. And so part of the mid-year update is we have to let you know kind of where we are as far as implementation, the data, so there's some narrative there, and then the budget expenditures. So we have our 1.1, which is our literacy across the curriculum. I don't want to sit here and read this for you. I think that you can probably just skim that. This is a lot of the information that Mr. Tippy presented back in January. And so this just really outlines a little bit more detail on the budget side. So if I go to the budget side, which is this page right here, because I know Mr. Campos, you were always asking questions about the LCAP. Well, actually, all of you have been. And so this is our budget. So the way this is lined up is the description of the items is in the first column, and then the actions that they're corresponding to are in the middle. And then we have our budget, and then we have our current estimated actuals. So that, as of, I believe, this last week, are our expenditures. So at the end of the year, or June 3rd, 5th, when our special board meeting, we will be presenting the final numbers, not only for our data, but as well as our expenditures. And so you can see that this is the breakdown. We provided this for you at our last LCAP report out last year in the summer, so the format is the same. So I'm trying to be consistent so in the things that you continually look at. So that is our LCAP goal one. Before I move on to two, is there any specific questions that you have maybe for myself or for Mr. Tippy before I move on to two? Okay. All right. Good. Okay. All right. He can relax now. And then, so these are the corresponding actions for our LCAP goal two, which Mrs. Cahoon shared early on in the year. I think it was October, November, where she went through. A lot of the data that comes in this particular goal are all of our graduation rates, things that are finalized from last year. So you can see, again, these are the actions that correspond with the expenditures. We go over our CTE pathways, our counseling program, our Aspire program, and the data that's involved with that, and our college and career readiness. And then if I go to this page, this is the breakdown for the expenditures that fall under Goal 2. And then, again, we have the expenditures, and then we have the actions that correspond with that, the budget, as well as the estimated actuals as of this last week. I'm going to give you a minute to take a look if you have any questions. And Ms. Cahoon is here, so if you have any specific questions on any of the actions or data, again, she'd be more than happy to come up and share.
Quick question.
Oh, yes.
There's one that says RCOE CTE contract. How many are?
We have, I think it's 20, 19, 20. We have all of our CTE teachers. I want to say that's like 19 or 20, 21. Mm-hmm. All of the CTE teachers, like at Liberty, we have some across the district. So we contract with the county mm-hmm. for that staff. So that's what that contract is.
Oh, perfect. Thank you.
And the lake as well. So we have about five of our internal candidates that hold dual credentials that teach CTE as well that also have a single subject. But the rest of them are subcontracted through the county. And we reevaluate that going through the year as far as program viability, you know, student interest. And so that's an opportunity for us to switch out programs if we need to, if they're not successful. It allows us a little bit of flexibility to work with the county to give them notice so that we can, you know, look at more current programs that are more viable for students. Yeah.
On the LCAP number one budget, is it one just so I understand if there's a name to that?
So the coordinators, the coordinator of Ed Services, that's Mr. Mark Sennett. The director of Learning Support Services, and that's partial, that includes myself and Mr. Tippy. Oh, we're back on one. I'm so sorry. Let me go back. No, that's okay. So the PD, yes. So that was either between consultants and food for the 2 days. Yep. Yep. Yes. That's the our October PD days. Yes. Yes. We'll Charles, I almost thought that you were off the hook, but would you like to come up and talk about the ELD sections?
Yes. Good evening. So the first line where it says ELD intervention sections, 31 sections, it's a combination of class size reductions throughout the district. So all of the comprehensive high schools, Pinacate Middle School as well. And those are smaller class sizes so that the teachers can provide additional monitoring, interventions, and supports. And then the one right below that, those are release sections for our EL teacher leads to provide instructional support to teachers and students in the classrooms. Yes. And then also to add, the 31 section also includes intensive reading intervention. So those are for our struggling readers. They use the Read 180 program. Requires smaller class sizes to provide individual instruction and small group instruction in their rotations. So those are combined in there as well.
Does that go the same for the math support sections? Because I saw only three schools there. Is that just for the schools that are just struggling the most? Or
Yes. Oh. So Paris High Heritage and Paloma.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So those are additional supports that we provide through the LCAP so that they can have a lower class size as well.
Oh,
and that might be,
okay.
I think they refer to them as
restarts.
Thank you, restarts, yeah.
Restarts.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
I think just want to add, as we move forward into planning for next year for LCAP Goal 1, and this is just the support that we provide our English learners, is that we'll continue to look at class size reduction as an intervention and support for our EL students as well. So that those sections tend to fluctuate, just depends on our number of students that are coming in. Any more questions on that part? Not that you can't ask questions later or after the board meeting. You are welcome to do that as well. So I will move on to three. So you have not heard from goal three, which is Mr. Atkins. He's gonna come up and he's just gonna share some data points and a little bit about the actions and the services as well. And then if you have any questions on the budget piece, I'll be more than happy to answer those questions for you.
Good evening, Board President Garcia, Vice President, campus board members, and Mr. Bennett. We've heard many of the data points back at the first semester with our NTSS systems that we have in place, and I plan to give a full presentation here within the next couple of months. So I'm gonna make sure that I keep mine brief to the 15 minutes, make sure it's in there.
I told him he could have five. The rest.
So the first goal, or first point in goal number three, is universal supports. We've seen a decrease, and I'm going to share out some numbers with you. We've seen a decrease in our discipline rate. We've gone from 6% down to 3% this year. We have our tier one supports by our drug interventionist specialists. They've had a total of 239 visits as of December. We'll share a little bit more so accurate numbers or more so more detail here within the next couple of months. Our attendance rate has gone up from 79% to 80% from last year to this year. And there's this clicker, I believe. Oh, okay. The next 3.2 is with targeted intensive support services. And this is with the training that we've provided our administrative staff. We've had 504 training by S2, which is an outside consultant group who's come in and trained our counseling staff on appropriate use of 504 and appropriate methods of 504 to show early intervention for all of our students. And with that training, we've also moved our counselors and our forms to Inform K-12, which makes it easier to communicate our 504s with our staff members when a student is on a 504. So it documents the tracking and the articulation of 504 accommodations. So that's all within the 504 training and that intensive support before it gets to, bless you, tier two and tier three. Let that not come out of my 5 minutes. All right. Oh, okay. All right. Number three is student engagement and participation. And I believe Care Solis is on one of these, and I have that number for you as well. Our Care Solis, our total number of communications is 8,265 total communications from Care Solis. And in case you don't, sure, 8,265 communications. And in case you don't know what Care Solis is, it's it connects our students with mental health across our district. Our counselors are our main users of the Care Solis program, and they use it to connect. And our counselors get this on a biweekly update as to our connections. We even had Care Solis come to one of our counseling meetings and give another presentation to ensure feasibility and usability. Goal number 3.3 is student engagement and participation. This is really focused on and looking at our attendance rate, and I've worked very closely with Ms. Candace Raines and business department and looking at our attendance rates, how to most accurately take attendance in our district and making sure that we have some accountability. And we are going to articulate a new system going forward and how we can make sure that we're using IC more effectively so that everyone is communicating the same thing, speaking the same language. So, and then safety and security. Goals 3.4 and 3.5 is our wellness centers that are in there, safety and security. And I do have a number for our wellness centers visits. We have a total of 9,000 visits to our wellness centers by a total of 3,283 students. So we have some students visiting multiple times. So that's 9,000 visits by a total of 3,000 students. For our wellness centers from this year.
I think I'll just add, if you remember last year, I think it was you, Mr. Stafford, was very adamant about the wellness centers and, you know, implementing that even when Dr. Newman was here, if I remember correctly. And so that's been one of our initiatives. So this particular action has been fulfilled as far as opening and getting the wellness centers up. So that is why you see a zero and that this has been fully implemented. So you won't see this particular action moving forward. So the support services that we're all desperately trying to, you know, regain and still provide services in the Wellness Center will be continued on into the next year's LCAP, and some, at least the information portion of it. So that's why you see a zero there.
Okay. And that takes my 5 minutes. Good job.
Was good that
job.
Good?
I think so. Okay. Any questions?
Quick question. I know you talked about trainings for 504s for counselors, but also staff members as well. How many times do you do those trainings? Is it like once a year or once every?
We did it once a year this year. We split our counselors into two different groups to train them, and we are going to do it again for next year and for our staff as well, especially as we move our forms to more of an electronic form. We need to make sure our staff are trained in how to and what to look for.
Okay, good. And then do you guys do some type of, like, assessment to see, like, how, like, if there are mistakes, because I know those are very hard documents to really keep in check too, and then I know it gets very challenging because it's, you know, 504s, and then and it's also IEPs as well. So I just want to make sure that everybody knows what they're doing, and like the less mistakes, the better.
Sure. Yes. We have a very good communication system set up. Okay. So if there's a question or any contentious case comes up, they'll contact my office when it's a 504. If it's an IEP, they contact Mr. Alzabedi and his office. And we also have, I have the director of, Ms. Jones, she goes in and sits in on those to help assist our APs, any mm-hmm. contentious, and we have our program specialists who come in and sit in on some of them as well.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
The community liaisons?
Yes, those are classified support okay. folks. Do you just name?
No, yeah, that's good enough.
Okay.
And then I noticed on the safety and security training for campus supervisors as well as, where did it go? It was 30. Oh, gosh. Care Solace?
Mm-hmm.
So I see it in the revised budget, and then in the estimated there's zero. Does that just mean that that money is there for them to still have access to, or?
Yes, and I think for the safety and security, some of that might be done through credits. That might be security credits or things that are generated in risk management. But there is a budget still for Mr. Hammond for $15,000, just in case. Yes.
Okay. Okay, so is that our exact number of dollars in safety credits?
No, that's not in my domain. I don't know. That's in risk management. I think that.
Okay. Can we put an inquiry to get that exact dollar amount? That's remaining balance. Thank you. I mean, Care Solace, the same thing. They just haven't used the funds. Or...
Well, I think that Care Solace might be funded under another for. It was intended for LCAP, okay. but it may have been moved to Title I.
Got it. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Almost last but not least, small but mighty, is our LCAP Goal 4, which is our, you know, communication, two-way communication with our families and our community. So we have four activities here. First one, a parent-teacher communication. So there's no data. I'll report that out in June at our first board meeting, information board meeting. That's in progress right now. So I'll be sharing the survey results with you when that comes in at our next presentation as well. 4.2, this is where I think our community liaisons on my side of the house, because the two that you were referencing work in attendance or in pupil services. So I know that most of you see the ladies out there working very diligently and hard at the open houses, a lot of the training. So I think we really do a fantastic job with our parent leadership. This is just a very short list of the many things that we offer our parents and our community as far as workshops and trainings. And so that is something that I think that the ladies do a great job. I have another short list, but you can see most of you have even participated in some of the trainings. Mr. Stafford, I know you go a lot to the lake and participate in a lot of the outreach and programs there, so that's very much appreciated. The last two actions that we have is, this is our 4.3, is where we house all of the financials. That's where all of them are paid out of this particular one. And so that really houses their salaries. When we look at the participation rate, we really just take a head count of the number of folks that are participating in all of the different events. So we have exceeded our parent participation in numbers from last year already at this point, and we still have open houses and several more events to go till the end of the year. So we'll definitely be meeting and exceeding our participation for our families and our community in this particular category. Last one is our effective two-way communication. So this is where we track our social media accounts. We utilize our information system in-house, Blackboard and IC, to be able to disseminate information to our community and our families as well. So we use that as just kind of a guide, and I'm just really contemplating whether to continue with the social media, because there's just so much fluctuation in there. And I'm not sure if it's an effective measurement right now. So I think we might be looking at that moving forward as a way to use some different data analytics to capture, you know, the information flow going back and forth in that particular action. So this is the breakdown, not as much as the other ones, but it's small but mighty. But these are our breakdowns for our LCAP Goal 4. Let me know if you have any questions.
I have one on the yep. Healthy Kids survey.
Yes.
I see obviously that that's a cost for us, but I was under, and I might be misinformed. Does the district receive anything? I remember at one point yeah. we had to give it, and if we got like 85% participation rate,
there was going to be some kind of financial incentive. But how does that work with it? I know it's costing us to obviously implement it.
So we have, there's a two-pay grant, and oftentimes we get about $4,500 reimbursement. So we will seek that with WestEd. So that'll offset that amount. So it's not, they just give us a flat fee of like $4,500, and it's just a reimbursement after the survey is done through WestEd, California WestEd, I believe. Yes, yeah. So right now we pay up front, and then when the survey's done, then we typically get a credit back for that.
And then on the social media, is it used primarily, I mean, obviously disseminating information out to the parents, that's probably one of the quickest, easiest ways to do it. But on the feedback side, is it, is it a lot of just, you know, hey, great job, you know, likes, and, you know, or is it
where
you're getting feedback, and, you know, someone might say, hey, you know what, there's this situation or that.
Yeah. So that is the challenging part, is that getting that feedback from the community and parents. And so what we've started to do, which we need to be more consistent and moving forward, is that after we, at least in my area, working with our parents and our trainings and workshops, is at the end is to do a QR code and get that feedback from our parents after, it's a survey, but an electronic survey. With regards to social media, and Joe, you can tell me if I'm wrong, but I think there are some analytics and there are comments that we can see but are not public, but we have each of our community liaisons go to each of their respective school sites and they read any comments. So if there's any concerns or issues, we share them with Cabinet, we share them with the site principals if there's things that are coming up, things that are red flags. So that's part of their job as well, is to go in because we're able to see the comments on the back end.
Yeah, and the reason why I ask is I know we use a Let's Talk platform, and it's been very informative because it's kind of confidential, but parents can give information there, mm-hmm. and sometimes they'll give information that's going on, and it'll get to the site administrator. You know, they disseminate it to where it's supposed to be, and then it can get down to us, and then we can kind of look into the situation, you know, without anybody really knowing what's mm-hmm. going on. But it's valuable for us because we know, the parents know, and the community knows, right. Hey, you can share information. We'll take a look at it, and they flag it, and then mm-hmm. it gets down to us, you know, from the district office to the classroom pretty yep. quickly, and it's been a way that we've been able to eliminate and alleviate certain situations that, you know, could have been potentially a little worse.
And it's Let's Talk?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I don't know if we gave it that name, but it's, in Temecula, it's Let's Talk. It's a Let's Talk platform, and it just kind of, it tells you, you know, it asks who, what, and then you just type in the information. It sends it out, but it's been helpful for us.
Okay. That's just
and
another.
That's why I was hoping that this kind of, there was something there where they can, you know, someone hears something.
Not to the extent like what you're talking about, no.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. And then the last one is our LCAP Goal 5. So Goal 5 was, we added that last year. We will not, as far as I know, we will not have an LCAP Goal 5 moving forward because the two schools that generated this, if you remember, was Pennacotti and PALS, because we had two or more subgroups that scored that were in the red on the dashboard, and that was our students with disabilities and homeless. So with that came a pot of money that we are utilizing to provide supports for Pennacotti and PALS. I'm glad to report that those schools are no longer in CSI, so they have been exited out for this year. So right now, we'll report out on the final data in June, in the first part of June, with the data. So far, the ELA is, students in those particular subgroups have moved forward. Math, we're still struggling, but that's the work that Mrs. Cahoon is doing with Pennacotti, with the math teachers. So we're utilizing these funds for professional development for the math teachers at Pennacotti and aligning that with the teachers at Paris High as well. So there's been a lot of work that's in that area. And if you want more information, I can ask Ms. Cahoon to come up and just share a little bit that they're doing at Pennacotti.
Quick question,
yep.
Just because you brought up the math. Do we complicate math here? Like, I know in the past we used to just have sixth grade, and then there was seventh grade, and then it was eighth grade or algebra, and then we did have an algebra readiness. But now it's like compacted this and that, and it's just like it's a split. It's I don't even understand. We've been doing it for I don't know how many years, but because some of them are like, you know, they're pre-algebra dipping into algebra. Anyways,
I can answer that.
Yesterday. And you can do it briefly. I'm curious.
They're not integrated, but the Common Core standards are written in an integrated manner, which means that in Math 7 and Math 8, you're going to get functions, you're going to get geometry. They no longer use the term feed directly into the Algebra 1. So it's completely aligned. The new framework outlines this, and we're getting ready to roll that out. We're working with the county. The math standards are actually spiraled like NGSS, so you can't just extract. You're hitting all of them at one time because they want to teach math in application rather than in silos, so it makes more sense.
Thank you.
That was very pithy. Yeah.
Okay.
So there's no budget page for this. This is we received this amount of money for to pay for sub costs, contracts, the conferences, professional development that we've been sending the teachers to this last half of the year. So with that, am I doing good on time? You haven't cut me off yet, Sarah. I appreciate that. Was that a ding? That was a ding. Okay. There was a timer. Really, somebody was timing me. Okay, so on June 3rd, okay, let me wrap it up in 3 minutes. So then thank you, Candace. So on June 3rd, we are going to have the public hearing. So this is where we will share the current year 23-24 LCAP annual update. We will have final numbers. We'll be coordinating with the business department, ensuring our budgets are aligned in our expenditures. And then we're also going to be sharing with you our year one of the next 3-year cycle for 24-25 for LCAP for next year. And then on the 19th, so that first one is information. So we will come with a full presentation. And then on the 19th, will not be a presentation, but that will just be an approval of the LCAP. Okay, any questions?
Just one clarification.
Yes.
June board meeting is June 12th.
Yeah. So
I'm sorry, I did not know that. I was just going to the third Wednesday. I was just going with the third Wednesday, so my apologies. So we'll change that. So don't be here on the 19th, be here on the 12th. Yes. So that's all I have for tonight. Any questions?
No, thank you.
Mr. Stafford, any questions?
Just a thought on the wellness centers. Mm-hmm. I keep repeating myself with these. Let's don't dismantle them and let them be in the wind, you know. So if we are able to bring back programs or find something that a good use for them, because a lot of times we just keep going around in a circle.
Yeah.
And we'll build something, then tear it down, and build something, then tear it down. So let's be patient and, you know, you guys have put in so much work getting those in place. So
I think you know that a lot of us are working behind the scenes with alternate funding, and so we're just waiting on some grant results. And so I think we have, if I'm allowed to say, a good solid plan moving forward to keep them open and functioning.
Yeah. You did such a good job with that. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Item 13.1, discipline. February 2024 monthly suspension report. Action item 14.1, personnel certificated personnel action items. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 14.1 is a 5-0 vote. Item 14.2, personnel, classified personnel action items. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 14.2 is a 5-0 vote. Thank you for the wake up. Item 14.3, personnel. Approval of tentative agreement between the Paris Union High School District and the Paris Secondary Educators Association regarding article, I'm bad with Roman numerals, 7, compensation for the 23-24 school year.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? See none, please vote. Item 14.3 is a 5-0 vote. Item 14.4, personnel. The Paris Union High School District hereby submits its initial proposal to the Paris Secondary Educators Association for successor contract negotiations for the 24-25 school year. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? You're right.
Meeting.
And we at the public hearing to receive comments regarding this Paris Union High School District initial proposal to negotiate with the Paris Secondary Educators Association for the 24-25 school year is now open at 7:15. Are there any public comments? Anyone wishing to speak? No? Just in the back? All right.
And don't all rush at once.
Right? All right. The public hearing is now closed at 7:16. There's a... Continue reading that? All right. There is a motion by Mr. Nelson and a second by Mr. Stafford to accept the Paris Union High School District proposal to negotiate with the Paris Secondary Educators Association for the 24-25 school year. Please vote. Item 14.4 is a 5-0 vote. Item 14.5, personnel. The Paris Secondary Educators Association is submitting its initial proposal to negotiate with the Paris Union High School District regarding the 24-25 successor contract. Is there a motion? Are there any comments? Is that right?
Yeah, I think we need a motion first, which I'll make the motion.
Second.
And the public hearing is now open at 7:17. If anyone wishes to speak, please come forward. The public hearing is now closed at 7:18. Please vote. Item 14.5 passes 5-0. Item 14.6, building and grounds, award of bid number 022624, Paloma Valley High School baseball backstop replacement project. Do I have a motion?
Moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Please vote. Item 14.6 is a 5-0 vote. Item 14.7, building and grounds, resolution number 17-2324, resolution authorizing piggybacking for the purchase of DSA approved relocatable classrooms for Liberty High School. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? See none, please vote. Item 14-7 passes 5-0. Item 14-8, Buildings and Grounds, Resolution Number 182324, Resolution authorizing piggybacking for the purchase of the athletic track with installation-related equipment, materials, and supplies for Heritage High School, funded through the various facilities funds in the amount of $890,120, not the general fund. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 14-8 passes 5-0. Item 14.9, agreements with Idle Bailey LLP for audit services. Is there a motion?
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 14.9 is a 5-0 vote. Item 14-10, business award of bid number 030524, Paloma Valley High School walk-in refrigerator project. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, please vote. Item 14-10 is a 5-0 vote. Yeah, that's okay. Just making sure. Item 14-11, business resolution number 2023-24, resolution of the Board of Trustees at the Paris Union High School District approving the school facilities funding and mitigation agreement between Paris Union High School District and Minor Ranch LLC. Is there a motion? All motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Yes. Candace, can you explain this to me, please?
Ask my partner in crime there, Dr. Good, to step in if we need some help. But this is a mitigation agreement with the developer of the property that is surrounding Heritage High School, Brookfield Communities. So this is a mitigation agreement that, so the project was actually just working through the City of Menifee and approvals and all of that. And so what this mitigation agreement does is provides funding to the school district in lieu of and in an amount greater than we would have received if we had just collected developer fees. And that amount is equal to an additional 79% because of the impact of the facility. So that's something that Dr. Good and Hector and I have been working a couple of years with since Mr. Dave Bartlett came and first met with all of us and including Grant in that first meeting. Is there anything I missed in that?
The cliff notes.
All right.
Is this the piece of land that always was farmed next to the stadium?
Yeah, so okay. It borders that side, and this is one of the four words I struggle with. Can you help me out here? There's four words.
You bet. So bounded by Highway 74 on the north. On the north by Heritage High School on the east, by the railroad line on the south, and then Menifee Road on the
okay.
North, south, east, and west.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So no more. No more dust in the stadium. Okay. All right. Yeah. Okay.
There's a piece in here to help mitigate the ponding as well that we.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, so it's a good agreement.
Will that affect that? Has anything been done with that runoff? You know the creek.
Yes.
You want to speak to?
Well, not yet, but. Well, it has in part, because when the county came in and retention basin across Briggs, that helped a little. But Hector and I have talked to the developer, and there are further improvements that we would like. That's part of the mitigation agreement.
Okay, that's good to hear.
Yes. Thanks for helping out my directional.
Yeah, thank you.
Any more discussion on 1411? No? Please vote. 1411 passes 5-0. Item 1412, business approval of the 23-24 second interim financial report with the positive certification of the Paris Union High School District's financial condition. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second? Any discussion? Oh, Candace Rains will give a presentation.
Well, we have a treat for you, Candace Rains and Mimi Capistrano. So I think the final time I heard was 30 minutes. I know we've been talking about budget a lot. You had a very lengthy presentation with Dr. Price at the last meeting, which really was our second interim data. So we just wanted to provide just a little bit more information. We will be much shorter than that 30 minutes time us. All right, but Mimi's gonna get us started.
Good evening. It's gonna be short. So the second interim. So just to keep a background on the second interim is the report, the financial report, where we provide financial information from the beginning of the fiscal year, July 1st, to January 31st, and with this MYP multi-year projection summary. You've seen a preview of this at the last board meeting on March 8th, and basically all the updates that we already included in here in the revenue and the expenditures. We also updated the expenditures that includes all the action that was taken. The action that were taken at the last board meeting, and also the negotiated salary increase. It's already included in our multi-year projection summary. And with all these updates and revenue and expenditures, you could see the total ending balance for all the years, including the out years, which the ending fund balance comprises of our 6% reserve in the committed and assigned fund balance. So I'll take any question if you have any question regarding our MYP summary. Yes, it's exactly the same. And also the same information was also on our AB 1200, which is the collective bargaining agreement, which we submitted to our COE because of the required specified time for us to submit that for them to review and approve the disclosures. So this is just to give you a breakdown of the LCFF funding per ADA per our grade level. And we used the base from 22-23, and then we added a COLA this in the current year of 8.22%. That gives us the 23-24 base grant per ADA. We also added the grade span adjustment of 312 for only grades 9 to 12. And with that, using the 71.15% three-year rolling average of unduplicated pupil count, that added the supplemental and concentration revenue, which gave us the total LCFF funding of 12,934 7 to 8 grades and 15,375 for grades 9 to 12. So this is just a slide showing the historical data, including the current year and the out years of our enrollment in funded ADA. And with that updates that's included in our MYP summary, we know that we are being funded using our ADA capture rate. With the new information we included in our projection with our enrollment. We from the last time we updated it and reduced our enrollment based on the information that we gathered from our feeder schools and all that factors, data. So we made an adjustment of our enrollment in the out years. We also adjusted our projected ADA capture rate in the current year based on the information from our P1 we just reported, and with the assumption, we also changed the out years with the assumption that the rate of our ADA will stay in the same level as the current year. And this is to show you the summary of our contributions, the contribution to these programs from beginning 21-22 to including the three out years to 26-27 fiscal year. For special ed contributions to that program, we can see every single year that the contribution increases substantially. We have also the contribution to our mental health program, and also the required 3% contribution to our routine maintenance, or the RMA, which also increases every single year. We also added here the, we call it COVID ADA relief, which we already mentioned in the past that this is the one that we're waiting for our audit report to be finalized for us to be able to utilize these funds. And you could see in a 24-25 fiscal year and 25-26 that we're adding it back in the budget. So it's adding it back to unrestricted, contributing it back. So basically, this slide is a summary of the assumptions I used, we used, the district used for developing our MYP, or the multi-year projections. These are, you can see the COLA, that's the updated COLA based on the governor's budget proposal for all those years, and which is already included in the revenue calculation for our district. The enrollment, as I mentioned, that we also adjusted that based on the current information, showing all the percentage increases every single year. The ADA also, as I previously mentioned, that we updated it based on the current information, based on P1, which I mentioned with the assumption that will stay the same in all the out years. And the unduplicated percentage for all the years is also included in our projection. And the STIRS rate and the PERS rate was the retirement rate. We also showed here that every single year that rate increases for the PERS rate, and also included in our projection when in developing our budget and expenditures. And I'll take any questions if there's any. Thank you.
All right. So thank you, Mimi. As Mimi mentioned, this and Mr. Nelson as well, this is the same budget that you saw, you know, just a couple of weeks ago, but we were doing that sort of as a handoff to Dr. Price, and so we wanted to give Mimi the opportunity to provide you just a little bit more detail. Mimi has worked extremely hard creating lots of versions of the budget as we worked through all of the different challenges we've been discussing and working through. So I'm going to pick up here with district budget considerations. This slide could have equally, just as easily been called budget challenges ahead. And so I want to make sure that on the revenue side, We know that there are certainly things that can impact the revenue in our projections. The projections we have now are what we know now based on things like COLA that Mimi covered, but also our enrollment growth rate. We are still projecting to be a growing district, but not as fast as we have grown in the previous years. And so we're projecting that 1% growth in each of the out years that Mimi covered, but we need to understand that if that does not materialize, or if we grow, let's say, at 0.5%, that will change our revenue picture for the district. Similarly, we did increase our ADA capture rate by 1%, still not up to those levels we were pre-pandemic, and we hope under the leadership of Mr. Adkins we'll continue to increase that, but we increase, you know, over the coming years, that would be phenomenal. We've got to get our attendance up. That's really our bread and butter for the district. But, you know, we're looking at data from the first day of school until period one, the end of December. That looked a lot better, so we made that increase based on that. We've got to hope that that holds through. You heard Dr. Price talk a lot about our contribution programs, and we're not dissimilar from other districts in terms of special education, not only the population growth in special education, but the needs of the students that are coming to us and the price tag, so to speak, that's attached to that. We're dealing with volatile COLA and other out-year projections that we're dealing with at the state level. You know, when we are in 2-3% COLA environments, that is often just enough or not barely enough to cover increases that happen on the natural. So health and welfare increases, PERS, expenditures that just increase, you know, on the natural. Obviously, and you heard Dr. Price talk a lot about this too, we're dealing with decreasing district reserve levels. I mean, we're very fortunate that we have a high level of reserve to start with, because that's helping kind of stave off some of this, you know, over the years to come. But an ending fund balance, you can think of that as one-time dollars, and you can spend one-time dollars one time. It can't help us year after year after year. And then the last thing I want to mention is, you know, as we continue to take a very careful eye as we're looking at the different restricted funding sources, you know, you always want to spend your most restricted dollars first. And so we have a projected ending fund balance in the unrestricted general fund as of second interim. We'll continue working with our partners in Ed Services and looking at the various restricted funds that are available. And so when we present the budget for next year, that will include a projected ending balance for this year. You might see that ending fund balance change, and by that I mean it might increase slightly on the unrestricted side and then decrease at the same level on the restricted side, and again that's to help us with unrestricted dollars there. So moving away from the district budget, I just wanted to do a real high-level overview of where we're at state level-wise. So as you likely know, Governor Newsom released his proposal for the 24-25 state budget and K-12 education on January 10th. A lot has happened since then, and a lot actually happened just before that. But in that proposal, the governor projects a $37.9 billion budget deficit for 24-25. Primarily, that's because of the 22-22 tax collections being below the budget's assumptions to the tune of $26 billion. That is a less pessimistic revenue projection than the LAO used just a month prior. That number was $68 billion. The good news, if we wanted to try to find a silver lining, there are no new cuts or deferrals for K-12 education and core programs. That budget is balanced at the state level by a series of drawing down reserves and other, you know, deferrals and things like that. So as we all know by now, the projected statutory COLA for next year drops from almost 4% to under 1%, and that's significantly less, you know, than we were projecting and even going forward. A recession is no longer forecasted in 24 or 25 by most economists, but there are notable risks to the state budget and Prop 98. The LAO on February 15th noted that the Prop 98 minimum guarantee could drop by another $7.7 billion from the governor's budget estimates, and that's $5.2 billion in 23-24 and $2.5 billion in 24-25. So just some things, you know, to be aware of. Before I talk a little bit more about Prop 98, I just wanted to show our historical statutory COLAs. And so if you look all the way to the right there, you can see that 0.76 COLA, you know, following two very good COLA years. It's definitely an impact. And to understand that COLA is really beginning to normalize to historical trends. And we haven't seen COLAs above 6% since, I can't read that number all the way to the left, but it's been quite a while. But I just wanted to show you that slide that we stole from School Services of California and gave them the credit there. So I just want to move on just briefly to Proposition 98 as it relates to 22-23 and 23-24. So the governor's budget, as is always the case with Proposition 98, it looks at the prior year and the current year. So the prior year being 22-23 and the current year being 23-24. And you can see those drops there. And the sole driver in that change is the less than expected state general fund revenues, the taxes that we talked about earlier. So that's a drop from the enacted state budget on the minimum guarantee of $9.1 billion in the prior year in 22-23 and $2.7 billion in the current year 23-24. So I want to focus on 22-23 because that's really the big question mark out there, and it's the maneuver, it's being called now, the Prop 98 maneuver that the governor is proposing in 22-23. To solve that gap in 23-24, the governor's talking about a withdrawal from the Prop 98 reserve and then a reduction in baseline LCFF funding, and that's really due to statewide ADA is not as high as projected. So this is the Proposition 98 maneuver. I know Mike Fine at FICMAT calls it trickery, but it's the treatment of that significant drop in Prop 98 from the prior year from 22-23. And so you can see in the enacted state budget on the chart on the right, $107 billion, and then there, what the governor would do in this proposal is take $8 billion and allow schools to, which is good news, allow schools to retain that funding in 22-23 with the intention of accounting for it in the future. And this is, I know we don't normally geek out quite so much on the budget, but it's important because it can have significant impacts of what we will see in the May revise and ultimately in the State Budget Act. So the Proposition 98 funding maneuver is the governor's plan for addressing that drop in 22-23. It proposes a new type of funding shift that basically accrues that $8 billion in the prior year payments, pushes them to future years. Schools would retain all of that funding level that we were expecting, and this is last year, 22-23. What the state would do is they would no longer recognize this funding as an expenditure on their books, and the state would gradually recognize it over a five-year period beginning in 25-26. So it's a funding maneuver, as it relates to this funding maneuver, the LAO's office, they have major concerns with this maneuver. They're calling it bad fiscal policy and sets a problematic precedent. Similarly, CTA, ACSA, and the California County Superintendents have voiced similar concerns with this treatment of 22-23. LAO recently put out alternatives to the proposed measure as a maneuver, excuse me, as a starting point, and that would be using reserve withdrawals to instead address that shortfall. Reject, and this is where it's key too, reject new spending increases, including COLA. So that takes the 0.76 COLA down to 0% in this case. They have a number of other solutions, including rescinding some unallocated grants. So we'll have to see. Last week, the Senate came out with their plan, shrink the shortfall, their early action plan. And I just received notification today, but with no details. There was a joint budget deal reached, so we'll wait and see what the details are for that. So we tried to go really fast. We are available to answer questions if you have them. But as it relates to second interim, and again, it's the same numbers that you saw a couple of weeks ago, we do recommend, as does Dr. Price, you heard, because of the actions you took at the last board meeting, to certify based on the current projections that the district will meet our financial obligations in the current and two subsequent fiscal years. the next state budget checkpoint, so to speak, is the May revision, and so we'll have more information there. That is what we will build our proposed budget for 24-25 on, is that May revision. The legislature, they will adjourn tomorrow, it is, I believe, until April 1st, so a little pause period there. And as Ms. Martin shared, with LCAP, the same is true of the budget, with the June 3rd public hearing and the June 12th adoption for the board. So I talked really fast. If you have any questions, I'm available.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, there was a first and a second. Please vote. Fourteen-12 passes 5-0. 14-13, disclosure of collective bargaining agreement AB 1200 for the period of July 1st, 2023 through June 30th, 2024. Is there a motion?
Second.
Any discussion? See none, please vote. Fourteen-13 passes 5-0. 14-14, business authorization for purchase orders above $50,000, March 2024. Is there a motion?
Second.
Any discussion? See none, please vote. Fourteen-14 passes 5-0. Item 14-15, technology award of E-rate services agreement to Converge One for purchase of Category 2 wireless access points equipment. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second? Any discussion? See none, please vote. Item 14-15 is a 5-0 vote. Information items, 15-1, curriculum. Revised middle school science courses, science 5, science 6, science 7, and science 8. Item 15-2, curriculum, revised science course, environmental science. Item 15-3, curriculum, revised advanced placement social science courses, AP government, AP human geography, and AP psychology. Item 15-4, curriculum, revised world language courses, American Sign Language 1, American Sign Language 2, American Sign Language 3, American Sign Language 4, Sign Language 3 honors, American Sign Language 4 honors. Item 15-5, curriculum, revised world language courses, French 3 honors. Item 15-6, curriculum, revised world language courses, Spanish 1, Spanish 2, Spanish 3, Spanish 3 honors, AP Spanish 4, language and culture, Spanish for Spanish speakers 1, sorry, that threw me off, and Spanish for Spanish speakers 2. Item 15-7, curriculum, new career technical education course under the Agricultural Pathway 103, Agriculture Environmental Science. Item 15-8, curriculum, new career technical education course under the Agricultural Pathway 101, Agriculture Mechanics 2. Item 15-9, curriculum, new world language course, American Sign Language 4. Item 15-10, business information regarding the home-to-school transportation plan beginning July 1st, 2024. Item 15-11, business revolving cash report, February 2024. Item 16.1, closed session if necessary.
Not necessary this evening.
Wonderful. Item 17.1, reconvene in public session if necessary. Item 18.1, other items by the superintendent.
Nothing else this evening. Good answer.
It's a beautiful answer. Item 19.1, other items by the Board of Trustees. And let's start with Trustee Nelson.
Nothing, thank you.
Trustee Vallejo.
No, I'm okay, thank you.
Oh, wow, we're on a roll. Trustee Stafford.
Nothing for me.
Trustee Campos.
Well,
I'm going to break it.
there we go.
So I was looking at one of the presentations when they brought the military, and I forgot if it was Heritage or Paloma. But just for you administrators that are out there, if you guys ever need guest speakers, I was recently in contact with a friend of mine who they're looking for people in trades. And so they want to be, they kind of, it was kind of a weird situation because they approached me as to how would we, you know, be able to present to kids that there are jobs out there, these kids that are, you know, graduating high school who might not have college plans but want to get out into the workforce. And so, you know, and I don't know how the whole process works at a site level, but I do know that they were reaching out to try to do presentations to let people know, hey, you know what, we're interested in people. They're in the home building industry, and so they're looking for people or students to kind of get young, and so they can train them on how to work trades, start making decent money, and then kind of working their ways through that. And so, you know, feel free to email me, and I can give you the contact. Because it was something, you know, when he had asked, I was kind of like stumped. I was like, I don't even know how, you know, how to do that kind of process. And so if there's a career night or if there's anything being planned where, you know, there might be some students out there who, you know, are looking for an alternative route, you know, want to make some money, want to learn something along the way and build on that skill, then feel free to reach out to me and I can give you the contact and go from there. And then my last comment, I'm just kind of going back to the last board meeting. I hope you guys understand that, you know, you're free to express anything and everything you want. I think most of us who are here understand it comes with the territory. You know, whether I try to respond to emails, listen, I definitely read them all. I can't say that I respond to all of them, but, you know, the reality is you have the First Amendment right, and I don't ever hold anything against anything that anybody says, obviously, unless they're threatening. That's no fun. But at the same time, you know, understand that you're being heard. We're listening. I don't take it personal, and I can't speak for everybody else. But I know it kind of comes with the territory. And sometimes that kind of heartfelt, you know, passion or speech, whatever, it gets my wheels spinning. Not in a negative way, in a good way. And just to kind of think, well, hey, you know what? That person said this, and that person was, you know, impassioned to project this or that. And it so for me, it kind of, it makes me think about alternative ways to kind of come about and find a solution. And so, you know, I thank everybody who speaks, and, you know, I welcome that. And I like that from the staff, too, especially, like, if I'm on a site, because it's hard for us to know what you need without you expressing what you need. And then, obviously, you know, we can't give you everything, but, you know, we can at least kind of move towards something that's, if it's really, you know, on your radar that you need that, then we advocate for that. And, you know, we can't do that without you. And so just know that you have that support there. And that's pretty much it. You know, I think we're coming at the end of the school year, and it's always crazy busy. It's kind of fun. But at the same time, there's a lot of things that are going to happen between now and then. And again, I'm just trying to stay positive and see, hopefully, that we can find some solutions that are short term and most importantly, long term. So thank you.
I just want to say thank you to everyone. I have this crazy idea, and I would like to speak to you, Mr. Santos, after the board meeting, if possible. No more than 2 minutes, I promise. All right, thank you. Otherwise, let's move on to item 20.1, adjournment. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second? Is there? All right, any discussion? Any discussion? See none, please vote. Item 20.1 is a 5-0 vote, and we adjourn at 7:53 p.m.